I would like to share with you why I think repetition is one of the key elements of our practice routine when it comes to getting better at music. To illustrate this, I'm going to be using a line from my new book, Iconic Lines. This is basically a comprehensive history of jazz vocabulary all the way back from the 1920s to the modern day. And we're going to look at a Freddie Hubbard line from the 1960s. If you want to pick up this book and follow along, it's linked below in the description of the video. Both physical copies like this. I don't know why I always feel compelled to do that. Physical copies of this book are available from Amazon.com. Digital copies from my website, JanekGwizdala.com. Both physical and digital copies come with over 300 play-alongs, over 70 videos, and all the extra curricular material. And now let's use this Freddie Hubbard line to illustrate just how important repetition is, no matter what instrument you play or what style of music you play. Actually, let's reference a bass line first. It doesn't have to be 2-5-1s. It doesn't have to be altered scales. It doesn't have to be complicated harmony. It can be funk in E. Basically, it's the willpower to stick with an idea and repeat it so much that you don't just know it, but you can't possibly forget it. That's the big goal here. And yes, that's a short example of doing it with a bass line. Let's get to the Freddie Hubbard line. It's a 2-5-1 in the key of F, G minor 7, C 7, F major 7, and then a nice 5-7 of 2 to get us back to the top of the cycle. I'm going to play the line a few times around nice and slowly in the hopes that you will listen and transcribe it directly from here before going and checking out the book, before looking at the tab or the notation or whatever it is. I really want to get you to use your ear as much as possible. That's the line in its entirety. Play it a little slower. Don't be afraid to stop the video, rewind, go back over it. You have this visual reference in the video. You have this nice, I think, pretty well executed version of the line that I'm playing right here. I'll take it down a notch slower still. This is something that you shouldn't really have the luxury of. You know, I'm not a big fan of that. I'm a big fan of using your ear, transcribing things in real time. I believe the tempo that I transcribed this at was somewhere in, talking about Freddie Hubbard, who's quite a virtuosic trumpet player. That was the style of kind of hard bop back in the 60s. But here it is. This is the whole purpose of the video, is to have this information, this line, this vocabulary under the fingers, and to get to repetition, 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 just over and over again. Now, not mindlessly over and over again. That's very important. You want to be practicing with the right intent. You want to be practicing with purpose, and you want to be paying attention to a very few key things as you play. And those few things for me are the articulation, the time, the feel, the swing. You know, this is from that era of hard swinging jazz in the 60s. Now notice I'm looking away from my instrument. Even my eyes are closed at one point, at some point. So that should give you an idea of how second nature the idea needs to be before you can get to repeating it and practicing that repetition with the right intent. What you don't want to be doing as you practice for hours and hours the same thing is really working on fingering. You really want to do that first. Once you've transcribed the idea, then you want to work on it really, really slow in as many different fingerings and positions as you possibly can to work out how you can execute the articulation you hear on the record best for you. So obviously I've done that. I have the fingering together. So now I'm able to kind of let the notes be, like let them almost play themselves and concentrate on the bigger picture, the sound and the time. Those are two most fundamentally important things to everything we do, no matter what the instrument or the style. So that's really what's going on. Those are the perhaps the only things I'm conscious of, until there's a mistake, of course, and I have to go in and kind of put that under the microscope and fix it. Those are the only two things I'm really conscious of, is sound and time. And so far, just in one position and in one key. And something that comes with the book, obviously, to help that, are all the play-alongs. So there are, you know, three different tempos of every idea that's in the book, every line, every iconic line, three different tempos, and two versions of each play-along as well. One with the line, so you can play along with it and really lean into that articulation, and then the play-along without the line, so you can really kind of have your own version of it, your own expression of that line. That's one option, of course. Another option is a metronome. And the third option is what I'm doing right now, is being really self-reliant on my own time, on the confidence I have in my own time to practice and not to rush or to drag, and kind of stay pretty much in exactly the same zone. Fairly easy to do when you're staying in one position and in one key. Because again, the notes are kind of playing themselves. And you're really only concentrating on the time and the sound. It gets a little trickier when you're changing keys, maybe moving in half steps. Oops. And that's my process for half steps. And we only went from G as our two chord up to C sharp, I think. We only went a tritone, or maybe to D, to a perfect fifth. We still haven't even reached an octave. And already time is going by. This video is getting longer. You can see how much time it takes to put in a very limited amount of repetition. So when we zoom out and we look at the macro rather than the micro, you know, a typical practice session for me might be an entire hour of playing just this line, maybe in one place initially, just to get it under the fingers and into the ear, and then in half steps like we just saw, and then maybe cycle of fourth. So I'm moving from first chord being G. I'll tell you what the first chord is, the two chord of each phrase. So G minor, C minor, we go F minor, we go B flat minor, E flat minor, A flat minor, D flat minor. But that's the process, and we're talking about serious amounts of repetition there. The discipline element is really key, has been really key for me in the past, in terms of working with a metronome and starting out somewhere. And then change. Wow. See, there was a mistake right there at that low tempo, something that should be quote unquote easy. So you see, there are holes, there can be holes, and there are places to improve in all ranges, not just sonic range of the instrument, but tempo range, dynamic range, all of these things to take into account when you think about repetition in the practice routine. Now, I want to leave you with some actual practice footage of me from a few days ago. I quite often throw up the cell phone, just put it on the desk and play just so I can have some record of what's going on. I can listen back to my own time, you know, hear things that, oh, I need to work on that. It's really, really important element of my practice routine is the recording and documentation of it for future listening, future self-critique, and hopefully future self-improvement as a result of listening and being very honest about what I hear in my playing. So I'm going to leave you with, it's about 3 minutes. It might start to feel like an eternity, but it's just amazing to me the concentration you need to maintain the same thing, to repeat the same thing for just 3 minutes. It's with one of the play-alongs from the book, from Iconic Lines. Again, if you want to pick up this book, it is available below in the description of this video. Both physical and digital copies do come with all the play-alongs and all the videos. What I want you to think about is, as you listen to it and as you hear that line over and over and over again, and there are a couple of mistakes in there and I have to correct those, and I'm moving the articulation and working on the sound and the time, think about the fact that it's only 3 minutes, and it's 3 minutes out of probably 45 that I did with that. So we're talking about, you know, 15 times what you're about to hear is what I actually did in that particular practice session on that particular line. So just keep that in mind. Realize that you actually don't need that long to sit with the instrument and to sit with an idea, to really get it to seep into your subconscious. So again, you not only learn it and know it, but you learn it so you can't ever possibly forget it.
There we go, last few. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.